very well.
Maybe one said yes.
What was the translation again?
That means the food plane.
Food plane.
Ana means food, and Bhuvani means across the world.
Well, interesting.
And it always occurs to me, probably, you know, these musts on the subtle world, whenever they look down here, I think, all they ever do is eat. Sort of like worms or ants or, good Lord, don't they ever do anything? Eat and screw and sleep and
when
clean up. Is that all they ever do?
When Dr. Murthy was with us up in Maine, and Carolyn would be driving him around going up, doing those shopping errands, and he found a chocolate bar called Vine Chocolate. Soon became one of his favorites, but he would be riding in the car, and Maine is one of the largest, literally, one of the most obese states in the Union, and I would say, you know, at least 60% of the people you see on the street are obese, and very much so. And you go on, you go, why are these people so fat? I don't understand this.
Because they are anabhava.
Yeah, I'm honoring God. It's one of the five presences of God, as we were talking about yesterday. I'm honoring the anabhava.
I think Baba said a yogi who is in a sort of ecstasy or whatever can drink and eat energy for many years without food. There's a very famous saying amongst the Taoists and Buddhists too. The one whose prana is full doesn't eat. Mm. So those people who have developed their prana, fully awakened to their prana.
I remember reading a story about Abu Sa'id, who's one of the great masters. I don't know if he was a perfect master, sounds like it. 10th or 11th century, and he was seeker. He would like hang from his heels in a closet for months together. He was an ascetic like that. When he became a master, a sheikh, he lived like a king. And so this, you know, wonderful, he actually lived very extravagantly. He was always about to run out of money, and somehow something he never worried about it. But some ascetic type challenged him, thinking he was a phony. And so I think they both did a 40-day fast, and Abu Sa'id had no trouble with that. I think he just grew fatter. Having both passed that one, the next challenge was for 40 days to eat and never shit. The ascetic lasted about 2 days. So when you become a perfect master, you can
take it either way.
Yeah. Well, so I guess I'll just look at a few more little chunks here. By the way, if anyone happens to know the book and have something you'd like to look at, I'm happy to do that. But just give them little snippets. I was thinking maybe to start with some of the little anecdotal moments in Tibetan lectures and in their context. Just get I get very strongly from this a sense of a flavor of being with Baba, what it would be like. We don't have a description of it, but I'm surely, you know, Baba would be there and he'd be writing and someone would read it out, and Baba would make a joke or talk to this one or to that one, or, you know, it would be very engaging sort of experience. So this is a little episode to illustrate, I think, wonderfully. This is about someone you may not have heard of, but Shankarnath is his name. He joined the all-time Mandalay, means full-time today. Baba heard him sing, etc., etc. So here's a guy, by the way, in you may not know about the Sada Ashram in 1927-28. Five men, but just when the Mayor Ashram, leading into the Prem Ashram, was revving up, five men went into seclusion in these little cells right next to what's right now the samadhi, where like Mani's and Grave is right there. There were these cell rooms. So, and he was one of them. So this, here's where he first joined Baba. And so, you know, you can get the picture. He's, how do we say, he's in for it, right? I mean, once you join Baba, it's all loving and sweet, but then you're going to, you know, get tested for sure. They all had to go through that. So here's a nice little example of how Baba brings that in. So he's Shankarnath has joined the Mandali, and then Baba has, Shankarnath then left the room. He wasn't there through a lot of this which followed. And then he came in the middle. And let's see, where is this?
You're just there.
No, I'm not.
Yeah.
I have the page here somewhere.
It says, Vishnu was saying this.
Oh, yes. Yeah, that's right, that's right. Okay. So Baba had been talking about a stone. You should be like a stone. For you can take, where is this? You can garland a stone and put that, you know, little point. There, the tilak point
bindi.
There.
Hmm? Bindi.
The bindi. You can worship it and sing bhajans to it. Or on the other hand, you can spit on it and urinate on it, anything like that. And the stone doesn't care. It doesn't make any difference at all to the stone. So you have to be like a stone, he's been saying. So then at that moment, he said, as Sri was saying this, Shankarnath entered through the door of the Makanikas. Thereupon, Sri wrote out, Shankar, be you Kankar. And Kankar means a stone, like a little pebble. So you see, he's like, it's a joke. It's like, Shankar, be Kankar, be a stone, because he had just been explaining about that. But the part of the charm to me of this is that Bob is actually telling him what he's got to learn to do if he wants to stay there as one of the resident monks. He has to be indifferent to whatever Baba gives him. You know, he'll be praised, he'll be abused. He's just been telling about all of that. But he sort of brings it in as a sort of amusing little joke to really let this new Mandalay give him an indication of what's in store. And isn't it neat? I just think it's lovely. That is, you should be so free from feeling, unaffected like a stone, that nothing can move you. Passions, desires, anger, excitement, etc. Just as these feelings have no effect on a stone that is a solid, unrousable mass matter, so should you too remain immune to their effects and take no impress from them. For instance, stone would feel nothing. Even if one were to apply redhead, that's the kumkum, the little point, with full reverence and believe it to be a god. Nor would that same stone be affected in any way if you were to pass water, means urinate, right? Or heap dirty refuse, nark, over it. It is, I guess I lost it.
No, after all,
you were there.
No, you were there.
Was it here?
There.
Yep. All right. It is, after all, just a stone, entirely devoid of feelings. To such an extent, may you remain unaffected, even with this mind and intellect that always accompany you. Then you would deserve to be called a real yogi or vira, hero. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, all this yoga tap job. You see, he was very much. He was would sing bhajans. He was brought up in that kind of tradition. Oh, this yoga tapjap is phoka, useless, a mere false show for the outside world. And even where yoga is concerned, etc. So Baba's explaining, all that's useless unless you can become unaffected by whatever happens to you. So I think it's so charming how Baba would, a new person, and Baba would give him a hint, an indication of you know, what he's got to pass through. A lot of the other men there would know very well what all of that was about.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, this is one of those little indications within a talk how Baba would be engaging the guys who are there. Here's another little narrative. It's actually, let's see, falls a little bit. It's part of the introduction to the Tiffin lecture that we found in the diaries. And it's, okay, maybe I won't try to read this, but what this is about a, okay, I'll read a little bit. It's probably the fastest, easiest way. And this is a major Tiffin lecture. This is one of the very longest and richest and most varied of all of them. The conversation stemmed from the recent episode concerning a Hindu gentleman. I wonder, I think I need another one of these that has the laser on it. Yeah, this is, sorry, I got left it back here.
And what do you want someone else to read for you?
Would somebody want to read this out? That would be...
The conversation stemmed from the recent episode concerning a Hindu gentleman, a genuine bhakta, who had visited Sri Baba several times previously. Always in the past, Baba had freely given him interviews and discussed the various points he raised with regard to the yogas, tapjap and so forth. But it so happened today that Sri did not allow the gentleman to approach him in the usual manner, and this, despite the fact that he had been here at Maribad since the night before and waited for him all day long.
So he must have stayed in the Dharamshala. You know, Baba had an accommodation facility for people there.
Mm. Conjecturing on the cause of Sri's special attitude towards him on this particular occasion, the man finally opened his heart to Kakaji.
That would be Kakashahane, who was living in the family quarters where the Tiffin lectures would usually happen.
Explaining that today he came with the intention of speaking to Sri on money matters and certain difficulties he was facing. But, as the man now realized, Sri knew all of this beforehand and did not permit him even to come into his presence. This so impressed the gentleman, convincing of Sri's greatness, power, and lilas, that, having narrated all of this to Kakaji, he quietly walked off without uttering a word more. When this little drama came up for discussion later, Sri explained that, when the gentleman first came to him, Sri had asked him what he desired, God, or what the world sees as good. The man replied that he preferred God to the world. So when he came today with the desire to speak about matters other than God, he was shirking his promise. Sri saved him from actually breaking his word by refusing to allow him to come before him and broach worldly matters. He had to content himself simply with remaining nearby in Sri's proximity. The Hindu visitor was indeed a good man, Sri commented, sincere at heart, a premi, who had observed so much tap, jap, rat and other such practices. But with reference to the gentleman's inability to stick to his original intention, Sri went on to give the mandali the following good piece of advice, upadesh. This is how the world changes. It's all on account of maya, which you have to renounce before you can hope to aspire for spiritual advancement. The greatest weapons of maya are women and wealth. Come, Kanchan. Any so-called saint, sant, who keeps talking about these subjects is not really a saint at all.
Okay, that's enough. So you get a sense of the story, right? Mm. The guy had made a promise to Baba, and he was not going to talk about worldly things. I mean, he was probably going to talk about his money problems, it sounds like. You know, and he wanted help for Baba about his money. And Baba had asked him on the front end, do you want worldly things or do you want spiritual things? And the guy said spiritual things. And Baba didn't want him to break his promise. And so just wouldn't come out that day, wouldn't see him. And the guy himself apparently recognized his fault, realized that he had done that and repented and left. So I have noticed in reading about these things, Baba, that Baba, when people made promises, Baba really took them seriously, you know, like, especially with people who were his devotees, his lovers, and his disciples, and he would really remind them of it. You promised this to me, and here's a case where he's saving the guy from breaking his promise. See, I think it's a lovely little illustration of the way of his working with people. Even this guy is a casual bhakta. By the way, in the Tiffin Lectures manuscript, hardly any of this story is there. And we found it in Chanji's diary, which really fills up the story like this, lets you know. And this sort of illustrates to me that Chanji was weeding this stuff out because I think they were thinking of publishing it back then as a book, you know. And if it were, people would probably have known who this guy was. Would have embarrassed him. But now, 100 years later, no one has the slightest idea who it is. So you can actually get the full story reinstated. Bob is working with people. Here's another little, right at the beginning of this very Tiffin lecture, we have a little story of Balul. Do you remember Balul, any of you, Erich, talking about him? Mm-hmm. He's mentioned in the discourses of two. He's the first famous sort of divine fool in Sufi lore.
Yeah, Harun al...
I've forgotten the caliph's name, the very famous caliph of the Abbasid caliphate, who's dream. But this, I bet you heard some of these stories of him that Erich would tell. He was... The way that Erich would tell the story, he was supposed to be king, but he became a majub and wasn't competent to be the king. So his brother took over. And you may know the story of building palaces in heaven. You ever hear Erich tell that story?
Mm-hmm.
And there are various other stories he would tell. That's this fellow. So here we have a story about his brother who's engaged in a majub improvement program as part of his divine policy. Anyone want to read this out?
Balul was Salik Majub. His brother was a king.
You know what a Salik Majub is? It's the ninth state of God, Tuliyavastha. It's a it would be like a Paramahansa, we were just talking about Paramahansas earlier, someone who is sometimes conscious of the universe and sometimes unconscious of the universe while being God realized. A sometime thing, he's a sometime thing. A Salik Majub is a little bit more conscious of the universe than not, and a Majub Salik is a little more unconscious. But you know what Majubs are like, right? They're not prime marriage material, let's put it that way. So here's what happens if you marry a Salik Majub. I think it's hilarious itself.
His brother was a king who, failing to comprehend Balul's Majub state and desiring nonetheless to see to his worldly welfare, arranged to get him married, quite against his Majub brother's will, of course. On the bridal night, when the bridegroom and his wife had been forcibly, from Balul's standpoint, shut up in a room which the king brother had specially provided and furnished and decorated for the occasion, the new husband, Majub Sahib...
And I think Majub Sahib is a very funny expression. The Sahib is like honorable, respected, and Majub is anything but respectable. So it's like a very funny term, Majub Sahib. It's a hilarious term.
Majub Sahib pressed his ear against his wife's organ. Immediately he pulled away and jumped up, howling, "What a noise and confusion! Somebody inside wants milk, somebody wants tea, someone is asking for a slate, someone for a pen, and on and on. All of them want something or another. And who is going to give them these things? I'm not going to bother my head with all of this." So saying, Balul kept himself aloof and refused to have any connection with his wife, whom, as we saw, he had married only because he was compelled to.
So this is what happens if you marry a Matu. Now,
so, there's a bit of smackdown in the fire, so people shouldn't know.
Okay.
Thank you.
So if you marry a sadguru, he takes responsibility for the situation. A majud salik does not. You won't have anything to do with it. So I presumably Baba told this story himself, about another Baba story. Yeah. Let me see if there's some other, here's another little love. Okay, I'm going to jump to something else instead. But here's a... Baba told them a good bit about... gave them a lot of warnings about the planes. And some of what he said about that. This is the very first of the Tiffin lectures. Let's see if this is the right part. Yeah. Okay. Anyone want to read this out for plain stuff?
Why is the yogi thrown down to the stone form? As just explained, in the subtle form of the spirit that has attained a yoga state, yoga avastha, there arise temptations which expose the spirit to the chance and hazard of falling catastrophically into the grip and binding of sanskaras. This happens when the subtle desire to perform miracles is put into the gross action. And once that spirit gets enmeshed in the binding of these sanskaras, it is compelled to descend to their lowest state and degree. For all the refuse of past sanskaras created during the spirit's progress from the lowest stone form state to its present much higher yogi state, garbage that had accumulated and blocked its path and advancement had been removed by the spirit through the varied means of yoga samadhi. As a result, the way through which the spirit had advanced all this time, once clogged with the accumulated refuse of sanskaras, is now in the yogi state quite clear of obstruction. And so, when the spirit subjects itself once again to the binding and places itself under the weight of the garbage of these sanskaras, it is brought down precipitously to the lowest level of these sanskaras, for the weight of these sanskaras is tremendous.
Isn't that interesting? If you can, it's like you've removed all, the tremendous quantity of sanskaras, a lot of them from evolution, even from your evolutionary journey, and but they all come crack. You're like crushed to death. You're crushed under the weight of the sanskaras that you had removed, but then come back on you. I've never heard Baba describe it this way anywhere else. It's like, you're working in a truck and the thing falls on you. It's like a natural law. The weight of your own sanskaras destroy you.
Well, he discusses the idea of the fourth and yogi, etc., being all the way back to the stone state that they misbehave.
Mm.
But yeah, you're right.
This way of explaining it, I haven't seen.
Mm. Okay.
And by the way, this would have been kind of new to the Mandali anyway. I mean, Baba had probably warned against this in previous times, I don't happen to know, but we're talking 1926, this was early, but he's explaining why the law of sanskaras causes this to happen. You're crushed under the weight of your own sanskaras.
Besides this, there is another reason for the fall to stone. Miracles are illusions within illusion. And the cause of illusion is sanskaras. Which means, in short, that the spirit in the fourth plane, while performing miracles, gets gripped around the throat by these sanskaras so sharply and severely that it is actually crushed under their unexpectedly extraordinary weight. When it comes into the clutch of these sanskaras after some interval of yoga samadhi, it has to fall to the lowest station. This happens after the spirit gives up its gross body and dies. This same gross body during this period of yoga samadhi had all the while been utterly neglected, since the yogi was enjoying experiences of the planes and their paraphernalia through his subtle body.
So I guess you fall down to stone after death. That's all.
Doesn't Baba in another talk say that as soon as the desire takes him over, he comes to gross consciousness in order to perform the miracle? That's when the gross consciousness that
Oh, if this happened, I wouldn't expect them to live too long.
Yeah, I somehow would imagine it would happen. You probably somehow wind up dying not long after a severe piece of hours. Baba doesn't actually talk about that one way or another.
So it's not distinguishing between using the powers for good, which seems to propel him further, and using them for ill.
Yeah, Baba doesn't make that distinction here. He just talks about the use of powers that way. Yeah. When God speaks, he does make it clear that bad use of powers includes anything for material benefit of anybody. Even if you, like, materially help someone, that's bad use of powers. You know, if you heal someone who's sick, that's bad use of powers, actually. There's another fourth plane reference here. I won't pull it up, I'll just describe it, but it's about a perfect master named Akalkot Swami. If you go to India, there are posters of him all over the place. He's one, not as popular as Sai Baba or Shirdi, but a very popular one. He was 19th century perfect master. And Sai Baba had contact with him, as a matter of fact. But Baba says that some advanced yogi on the fourth plane came to him. And of course, the other people didn't know the status of this yogi. And Akalkot Swami was very jalali, very fiery disposition. And he said, he called him Randi Bazi, which means a whoremonger. He called him a whoremonger. And all the people around thought he had been consorting with prostitutes, but he didn't mean that at all. He meant that he was had been using his powers, actually. And so Akalkot Swami gave him a big, huge slap and knocked him up to the seventh plane. So where's the justice in the universe, I ask you? If he had caught him on the wrong day, he would have become a stone. And there's another...
Or maybe he had already done that.
Maybe it was his second time through.
Yeah, it didn't matter.
Maybe
time.
He just almost balanced his first sanskaras.
Yeah, maybe so. Baba has said elsewhere that if you're abusing your powers, if the presiding master is of the Jamali type, he takes away your powers. And is of the Jalali type, knocks you down to stone form. Mm-hmm. But here's a Jalali who knocked him up to the seventh plane, so maybe he just sort of, oops, I didn't mean to do that.
Either way, he got rid of him.
Huh?
Either way, he got rid of him.
That's right. He got rid of his problem. That was the main point from his point of view.
I don't want to deal with him a second time. So.
I mean, this could keep on happening.
Yeah. Groundhog.
Groundhog Day. He's coming back. There's another Tiffin lecture talking about the fourth plane in a different way. There are a bunch of yogis who came to see Baba. And the head of them, they call him a Buddha yogi, means a big yogi, a big shot yogi, who apparently had real humility and recognized Baba's authority. And so Baba told them about Yoga Samadhi and said, Yoga Samadhi is basically like having a rest on the path, but you don't make any progress. It's like take a vacation. But when you come back, you're just where you were and you haven't advanced at all. But then he gave this analogy for the fourth plane. Have you any of you taken the train from Bombay to Pune? Mm-hmm. You know, it goes very steeply up a gradient in the mountains there. Well, I guess if you go the other way, to Manmad, it's a more northerly route. It's the steepest railway gradient in all of India. So Baba was talking about that. And apparently they had the practice that you have an engine, but to go through that, another engine comes and pushes from behind, and they call it a gut engine. And the same is the case when going down. You have a second engine in front to slow the train, because if it runs out of control, they're all dead. So you have to have a gut engine. I guess that was a common practice. So Baba said, when you're going through the fourth plane, you need a gut engine to get you through, and that's the perfect master. And the way he described it to them, without a perfect master, you really can't get through. What he said to these yogis anyway. So that was an analogy and a description of the fourth plane I've never heard before. You need a push to get up through that terrible steep pass of the fourth plane. So people would come to Baba, and some of these Tiffin lectures, you'll have Baba holding forth with them. Here's a real, there's some interesting descriptions of what of the perfect master and his role and standing. And here, he describes, a perfect master, a sadguru. Baba wasn't talking about avatar in those days, and he didn't differentiate there. But he would talk about him as a Rajkumar. And what a Rajkumar is a king, a royal prince, a sort of king, a little prince child. So he says that that's what the Sadguru is. Want somebody to read this? The Rajkumar?
Somewhere. It is said that only a very, very few can attain the state of Purushottam, that is, a perfect sadguru, Purana sadguru rup.
Purushottam, uttam means best, and purush means man, the best of men. And Purana means a complete, the perfect form, rup.
For this state stands at the summit of realization and the merit of deserving layakat. For such a state must accordingly be the highest order. Even the Vedas, Puranas, and Upanishads cannot properly describe the powers of a Sadhguru in spite of the invaluable philosophy and knowledge that they contain. But concerning the Sadhguru, this simile, upama, can be given, that he who has attained to that state is like a young prince, Jivan Rajkumar, or a child. Just as a child prince has a ball to play with, so too the Sadhguru. The Ishvari Rajputra, or divine prince, has a ball, or rather many balls, for this same purpose. And what is this ball? It is the very universe itself, which to him, the Sadhguru, the divine prince, is a plaything.
Sounds a little scary, isn't it?
The whole trilok, three worlds, mind, body, and jiva, is like a garden, bagicho, for the divine prince to walk in. And every flower in that garden is a world. He can pluck and smell, which is to say, play with, any flower, food, he likes. Indeed, he has the freedom to enjoy its fragrance and preserve it, or, if he chooses, to destroy it, all at his will and pleasure. In other words, he can destroy the entire world, or even worlds, which, as we have said, are like a flower or flowers to him. So now, what do you think about the powers of the Sadhguru from what you have gathered in this explanation?
It's pretty amazing, isn't it? He's Pasmi Maharaj, Babashan, the powers and the authority that they have, they can destroy the whole world if they feel like it. And it sort of get a glimpse, at least I do, of what creation looks like from the standpoint of these, Sadhgurus. It's just a plaything. It's not even real. It's not even there.
Hmm. Well, we hope he's not a brat.
Huh?
We hope he's not a brat.
That's right. I hope you have a selection program that meets the brats out.
I think there's a poem when Ram created the world, he's given his forethought to it. So he knows what he's doing.
Oh, well, that's all right. Yeah. Didn't like the little prince idea.
I mean, presumably they don't actually do this very often. But yeah. I don't know, it gives me, it's like looking at the Sadhguru from a different point of view, from the real point of view, where the whole universe is just toy. It's not even there. It's not even there. So the unimaginable majesty of these people, I was giving a little glimpse of it. Here's a little episode where Baba got approached by a bunch of big shot politicians, and Baba made some very frank comments about it all. Guy here, actually, again in the typed manuscript, very little was said about the whole who these people were. But in the diaries, there is a much fuller account. We learned what Baba said to these people and who they were. This particular man, his name is Harenjipe, and he's a very famous fellow. He had begun to agitate for Indian independence in the 1890s. He was a fiery orator, and He might even have been agitating for violent resistance to the British. But when Gandhi came along, he joined up with Gandhi's nonviolent movement. He was the editor of a magazine agitating for Indian independence. I think Vivekananda's brother was also. So this fellow would be in the short list of leading writers and journalists from that period. I imagine if you really studied the Indian Swaraj. Swaraj is the name of the Indian independence meeting. Swa means self, and Raj means rule, self-rule, independence, Indian independence movement. If you studied that, I imagine this guy would come up as one of the main players. And so it turns out that he and his people showed up and met Baba. It doesn't make altogether explicit what they wanted, but I would think it would be pretty apparent this much that they were, canvassing for an election. It does say that. And I'm sure that Baba, as a new up-and-coming master in Maharashtra, was someone whose endorsement they would like. You know, say, yes, we saw Sri Mihir Baba, and he gave his blessings and said, we are doing good work. And imagine, you know, the politicians, that's what they would be looking for. And in the version that's in the typed manuscript, very little of this is said. And I'm sure the reason is that Chanji didn't want to publish a book that gave Baba's very frank comments on politics, and thus to alienate Gandhi's whole movement, you know. Now, 100 years later, it's very interesting to see how completely straight Baba was with him. And if you, you know, the Gandhi's independence movement, seems to me, among political movements, it's about as idealistic as they come. I mean, Gandhi was himself a very noble and great man, and there are a lot of noble and great figures in it. And even then, Baba would not bite. So, you want me to read this out?
A small group of four or five energetic and enthusiastic workers of the Swaraj Party dropped in today. The number included a Dr. Haranjape, editor of Kal, and another editor of an illustrated Marathi magazine.
So these are prominent people, right? It's not like there are magazines all over the place in those days.
They happened by en route from another city, where they had been canvassing for votes for a candidate in the forthcoming council election. After touching upon general topics, conversation turned to Swaraj and what India and Indians should do for its attainment. The party leaders, in their eagerness to impress upon Sri the importance and value of their work and the interest they took in it, betrayed their self-interested motives, which is to say, their party politics. Whereupon Sri imparted to the group of them some sound and severe advice, writing on his slate. What is politics, after all, but fraud?
So how much do you think they'd like to hear that?
Whatever may be your honest and candid opinion, you are obligated to proceed according to the creed of your party, even against the voice of your own conscience. And thus you become dependent upon others in your actions, a practice which violates the fundamental principle of truth. Sri impressed upon them all that, in whatever you do, don't go against your conscience. Following its dictates, come what may, and he who succeeds in this comes nearer to true Swaraj, self-control, than can be achieved through any amount of the sham and show of party politics, congresses, and conferences.
I mean, Baba is giving it to him completely straight. You know, this is the avatar. You know, Baba would have every reason to flatter them. You know, these are powerful people. This is the up-and-coming movement. He's a new up-and-coming guru, and we'd get great mouth press from them. He supported them. But he just told them the truth. Even though it wasn't at all what they had in mind, it was short.
And then one of them asked the question, will India attain Swaraj? And if so, when? Sri answered with a question of his own, what do you mean by Swaraj? Political independence, replied the inquirer. Then Sri explained the whole subject in clear and beautiful terms.
See, Baba's not going to buy this term Swaraj. So now he's going to give his own explanation of what it really means. And this is actually what appeared in the Type II of the lectures. It basically begins about here. This whole background got left out.
On Swaraj and self-government, political and real. By Swaraj, what I mean is the gain of truth. That truth which is already the property and birthright of everyone. What I mean, in other words, is spiritual independence. As for political independence, no doubt India will get it in the future. We need not worry about it.
That's the whole thing of what they came for. Don't worry about it. No doubt it'll happen.
It did happen.
The political independence is easy. This political independence is easily won. But real spiritual independence, that is achieved only with great difficulty. Hence my advice to you all is, seek that truth which will give you everlasting bliss and real knowledge, Nan, thus enabling you to raise others as you have been raised to, as you have been raised, and to save them from the entanglements of the world. Anything sought in connection with external affairs is mere foolishness from the point of view of realized persons who have actually seen the truth and become one with everlasting existence, as compared with those who have learned merely through reading and learning. Within 10 years, India will enjoy extraordinary freedom.
Whatever on earth that last sentence means, I have no idea. Yeah. But I mean, I think this is really wonderful. Baba, they got so much better than what they came for. Baba gave them the real thing. And he didn't, Bob's being nice, he's not insulting them or anything, but he told completely the truth to these people.
That's so important for politicians to hear that first thing today.
Yeah.
People in politics are just...
Yeah.
Bob had actually supported, when India got independence, Baba supported that. I remember Erich's dad, Pop Pistol, they called him, was very unhappy on independence, the actual Independence Day. I imagine as a Zoroastrian, the Zoroastrians were probably not as enthusiastic about it as others might have been, because the Zoroastrians tended to be favored by the British as a means of dealing with the problem with the Hindus and the Muslims. It might not augur all that well. Yeah, it's an understandable point of view. So he wasn't going to fly the Indian flag on that day. And Baba told him, no, fly it. You should fly it. You should support this country. And it's a good thing. So it's not as though Baba was opposed to this, nothing like that. But he wasn't going to get diverted by the appearance of these important people showing up at his ashram. He would just... straight. There was another Chitin lecture a little bit earlier than this, August 5th. I don't know if any of you met Erich's uncle. His name was Nashirwan. Any of you? What did they call the place? We would stay there. Did you ever stay there?
Yes.
And, now I'm forgetting what we call it.
Mayor Colony.
It was 7 rupees a day, I remember that.
We would
be why I stayed there. And he ran that facility, Akbar Press, right near Akbar Press. Right now the bus station is across the street from it, and it's big businesses and big buildings. It's all the old place is gone. But he was very a very high-ranking guy in Gandhi's movement, the Swaraj movement, as a matter of fact. And he had a chance to join Baba. Baba had asked him, but he wanted to see Indian independence on through to completion. And later in life, he greatly repented having missed that opportunity. He was the one in that family who made contact with Baba first, actually. Marriage is on. But he's there on one of these talks, and Baba gave a long talk about independence and freedom and service and what all those things mean. It's a really wonderful talk to all of them. He and another of Baba's followers in Nagar were very much affiliated with Gandhi and the independence movement, took a big part in that.
Didn't Baba say somewhere that for India as a country to lead the world spiritually, it needs independence?
Because he did say that. So Baba seems to have supported Indian independence. He clearly was the divine will, but Baba indicated that he needed it. And you know, those were very noble leaders, it would seem to me anyway. But even so, even with that, you know, Baba's not gonna, he's gonna actually give them the truth, a straight shot on the whole thing.
The real freedom is spiritual freedom.
Mm-hmm. Right? He says, what is Swaraj? What do you mean by Swaraj anyway? And that's a lot of what his talk to Nashwan is about. You have to rule yourself. He says all other kinds of freedom, you know, erode. You can gain them, but then you can lose them again. None of these other freedoms are lasting. But this is the one freedom that once you have it stays forever. So he told them that. Here's a nice little, I'm just giving you little snippets from here and from there, about listening to the voice of your own conscience, which is the topic we just saw there. Let's see. Yeah, this was right at the time Baba had just told them, just dissolving the Mirabad ashram, that big shocker. So he was talking about being unaffected by what others say. So he gave them this, even about a master, listening to the voice of your own conscience. Your mind must be as firm as a rock that resists strong blasts of wind from all sides without budging an inch. This saying alludes to the weakness of mind that people exhibit when they do things half-heartedly, just for show, before the eyes of the world in general. Many times against the voice of their own conscience, will, and wish. For instance, suppose your mind and conscience honestly admit and tell you that offering complete surrender to a Sadhguru will do you good. In that case, do it. Surrender to him your heart and soul, even if the voice of the whole world tells you otherwise. Even if the whole world opposes you. And remember, this is a very relevant issue at this time. There could have been a lot of people who actually had met Baba and felt he was real, but who didn't dare to let others know that because there was such opposition to him. Now we have the opposite. Do not do it merely to please him, nor out of fear of incurring his displeasure, nor to please and make a good show before other members of the mandala. In other words, don't profess your surrender to Baba just because you want to please him. Right? You have to actually feel it yourself, is what he's saying. In just the same way, if your head and heart refuse to admit the existence of any such power in him, the guru, if they distinctly tell you not to bow down before him, then don't do it, even at the risk, again, of provoking his displeasure. For the true guru would, on the contrary, be pleased with such an honest, open, bold action on your part, preferring it to a false show of submission and surrender. This is a very strong affirmation of the voice, the inner voice and conscience, and don't violate that. There are many who seek the Sadhguru's darshan and visit him, yet at the same time are afraid of the world's disapproval and mockery, that they're stooping and bowing down before that sage's feet. They do it nonetheless just to satisfy their own mind and soul, which honestly call for such acts of submission before him, but they do it half-heartedly like cowards. Furtively, looking about here and there before falling at his feet, to ascertain whether some outsider, skeptical of such carryings-on, has seen them stooping and prostrating themselves in this way. Can you imagine that? It's like, oh God, what if so-and-so finds out that I'm here at that Baba's ashram? Quick, bow down and run away. I don't know, I like this. It really shows Baba's, be bold and be true to your own self. Don't even let the master bully you into it. You have to actually feel it yourself. So this was right at this time when the ashram was, he had dissolved the ashram and there was there must have been tremendous criticism coming at Baba right then for having ended all these noble philanthropic institutions that he had started. Here's something on the, okay, let me look at this one. This is in a few minutes. Baba gave a long discourse on renunciation. Let's see, what is it?
There's something about renunciation.
Yeah, there we go. This is the baby. Okay. So on this day, Baba gave a discourse on this topic of vairag, renunciation. And right after this Tiffin lecture, Baba said, well, let's do it. What do you think? Let's just take off and renounce everything. And, Mamali said, okay, let's do it. So right then and there, Baba was going to take off and in an hour or two leave Mirabai and go out begging for a month or 2 months or whatever it was. And they were all prepared to do it. It gives you a feeling. It was like living on the edge of a knife. Any one instant, everything could be given up and abandoned and you could be out on the road. And then when they were just about to do it, Baba said, no, we'll do it for just one day. He had all these rules. They're just supposed to beg, not bring any money with them, all that. Sounds like the new life. So he actually did it 25 years after this. But then they took off for a day, and it turns out they went to the town of Walki, which is about 5 kilometers from Mirabai, if you ever really want to go there. It's just a short drive. And there was a whole big event that wound up happening there, and they returned at the end of the day. But it shows how dynamic everything was. Any moment, everything could change. Mirabai could be closed, everyone could go, they could just take off, they could have no money, no means of providing for themselves, but who cares? That's the spirit that was there at the time. So that happened right after he gave this this talk. But this is a really significant discourse on this subject of renunciation. And here's some little snippets from it. Baba's talking here about to succeed in internal renunciation. Talks about external renunciation and internal renunciation. Company of and residence with the sage offers the best expedient and remedy. Do you know the word, a lot of the Tiffin lectures are about this satsang. This is a good word. Satsang. Sat means truth, and sang means conjoining with. So keeping the company of a sage or a perfect master, that's what satsang is. And he gives that as really the best path to God, is satsang. And here he describes some different types of people doing this. The company in residence with the sage offers the best expedient remedy. Doubtless they do well who, remaining in the world, observe and practice renunciation. But the case is quite different for those who renounce and then live in the company of a sage after renunciation. Now, those who practice satsang can be divided into three types. And I find this to be rather striking. One, he who gives, takes not, and stays. Ekdeto yetnahi varahato smarati. Number two, he who gives not, takes not, but stays. And here's the third category. Who he gives not, takes, and stays. What do you think about these three types?
Key thing is to start, I guess.
Yeah, stay with him. I mean, if you were to rank them in terms of best to worst, obviously it's 1, 2, and 3, right? People in category number three, I don't know, sort of like the avatar's ability of somebody who doesn't do a lick of work and consumes everything, lives off the benefit of what everybody else does, and is always there. You can't get rid of the bugger, you know. So, obviously, this would be the type he's liked. But actually, what matters is to stay with the Sadhguru, whatever you are. Stick with them. That's what I take this to mean. What do you think, Tian? Do you think so?
Maybe Baba has a further explanation.
He does go on to this a little bit more, yeah. But I've never seen a categorization like this. So the thing is, be with the master, whether you're good or bad. Even if you're if you're in category three, I imagine the master is going to be doing something about that state of things sooner or later.
In the Great Learning by Confucius, it says something like, those people who seek the Tao, seek God, I think three categories, two. One is forced into it. One because he loves it. One reluctantly does it.
Yeah.
But when they reach the end, it's the same. There's not the same, but more or less. There's another thing is, whatever makes you do it, when you get there, it's the same.
Yeah. If you just, you know, it reminds me of the Staji would be a different, would not be a true member of the third category, but Baba basically removed all work from him. He had no work to do. And sometimes it would drive the others crazy. And I remember Marwan telling, I think they were Papa Jesuala, you know, a very fiery guy who had been very hardworking and had risen very high in the ranks of the British Raj. I think he was one of the highest ranking non-Brits in some whole branch of the civil service or the administration, whatever. He was an engineer. So he definitely was a hard worker and knew how to work. So he was going, driving up some mountain, some big hill somewhere, and Gustaji was in the seat next to him. And he came to there were rocks in the road, some problem. So he told Gustaji, because he was driving, right? So, get out and move those rocks. You got Gustaji?
No.
And so Papa Jeswala blew up and he said, like, these useless people. But in fact, Gustaji had the director from Baba not to do things like that. And so he didn't care. He was going to obey Baba. So he looked like completely useless. So Baba would use the staji like that a lot, where he's, people would think he was just this lazy, worthless guy. Actually, he was obeying Baba better than anybody.
When did Baba have him take silence?
Yeah, in 1927 or so.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And he kept silence until he died.
Right.
All those years he kept complete silence.
When did he die?
58.
58,
was it?
I think as Baba goes on to say, all these give and take pertain to the material things.
Yes.
But Ustaji, who doesn't do things, who knows what spiritual things Baba has done through him?
Clearly, he was a very, he was one of the, he was one who was of the inner circle. You know that.
Baba, that's it.
Yeah, so he was one of the really great ones. And the first two types in this list, those who take not, rank more highly. The first, right, who he called heroes, virla. Baba talks about, uses this word, virla, as a hero, you know, a hero, in the Tiffin lectures. It comes up sometimes. And the second, the best, uttam. Those of the third category who take number among the ordinary. But all three derive great advantage, for the essential point is that, after renunciation, they remain in satsang, with the business of giving, not giving, and taking, all depending upon their sanskaras, descending from the past. All three stand far above the so-called sannyasis of the world. Not just the first two types, who take not, but even the third, who takes but remains in the sahabas or company of the guru. But the ordinary sannyasis of the world who have, so Baba's showing where, you know, what real renunciation means. But those ordinary sannyasis of the world who have renounced everything are, in a way, better than the ordinary people of the world who still remain in the clutches and entanglements of maya and materialism. To abide, now this is a lovely sentence, to abide in satsang means to obey the guru's orders. That's what's up. That gives some hope for us, even here today and now. Here's some other things. We have these things, question is an answer, and although our texts don't tell us, I would imagine this would be Mandalay asking things and Baba answering. We don't know that for sure. And a person who I think would be asking things a lot was Rustam, Baba's older brother, who married Franey, as mentioned this morning. Why did Buddha renounce everything in order to attain to what is real? Why did Ramakrishna renounce everything in order to see and become one with God, Ishwar? Why did Tukaram renounce everything? He became disgusted with the world because of continual losses and failures in business. He was high on the list for the worst businessman of all times. Having renounced the world, there was created in him the love of God. After this, he had to pass through further untold sufferings.
This is before he became a perfect master.
Yeah, yeah. That's a very young. This is a very interesting quote from, he doesn't say who it is, but the poet here is Ghalib. It was one of the great bird poets of the 19th century. This continual doing and being drowns everything in the sea of illusion. But to do nothing and to be nothing, this means truth. Indeed, this is the truth. Nata kuch tu kudakta, kuch na huta tu kudakta, duboya mucho hone ni na huta mai tu kya huta. This is very famous. Actually, when I was in Delhi a year ago, I went to his grave, and this couplet is right on his grave. When I was not, when this being of mine was not, I was God. When I was nothing, I was God. But this being, My own self-being drowned me. Oh, had there not been this accursed I, in what unlimited, infinite ocean of bliss, anand, would I have been? And this lecture ends with a real strange analogy, one of the strange analogies you've ever seen. Okay, does someone want to read this out? Just give us a stopping the machine.
Let's take another concrete figure. I want to read so I can keep awake. To illustrate how the ordinary human awake state and the being and doing of mind are brought to an end. Imagine a machine at work. It runs continuously. Now, if you approach the machine and cry aloud from a distance, "Stop operating, please!" Of what use is this continual whirling and revolving of yours? Do you expect the machine to desist from its operation simply because of your words and loud cries? Certainly not. Then what is required for your purpose? You need someone so bold and courageous as to grab hold of the machine as it is running, and by sheer strength to force it to stop and to operate no more. For the machine on its own will never stop until such a one arrives who is daring enough to venture and manhandle it. Now imagine further that this machine has a big wheel and many sharp points.
That danta is like teeth. It's kind of the word for teeth.
One could not seize hold of such a device even when it is at rest and stationary. To grab hold of this deadly and dangerous mechanism when it is in motion would be to risk one's life in vain, since stopping it is next to impossible by any ordinary means. So then, what would an expert do to stop such a machine? First of all, he would take up some suitable instrument and, standing at a distance, use it to break off the sharp spikes. Only when this had been accomplished would he venture to use his strength directly to stop the wheel from revolving. Not otherwise.
Isn't that a powerful image? This whirling thing with blades and the expert stopper knocks off all the teeth. And originally we had no, in the next thing, all the words were missing. I'll just give you an idea what it said. It says, the machine, the machine represents blank. The wheel represents blank. The points represent blank. That's what I had for 15 years. This is one of the things that drove me nuts. I mean, I can make my own guesses, but I don't have the right to do that. And we found it with the persons. We got the answers to it all. I keep going. This is Baba's explanation.
In this analogy, the machine represents the life of ordinary mankind. Manushya.
Manushya means ordinary mankind.
The wheel represents birth and rebirth in the body, sharira. The points represent sanskaras. The instruments represent good actions proceeding from infinite power, knowledge, and knowledge. Anant, Shakti, and Jnana. And the expert stopper represents the God-realized Sadguru.
I'm not clear about the instruments. The good actions proceeding from infinite power and knowledge of the Sadguru or of the ordinary person?
Yeah.
Seeker.
Well, it's the expert stopper who picks up the instrument.
Yeah.
But the good actions
yeah.
represent the good actions. Our form. Good actions are the Sadhguru or by. Because Baba says from good to God. So we have to do good actions.
Yeah. No, I mean, literally speaking, I guess it's the Sadhguru who good actions these mm-hmm. are, but it's hard to believe that. In actual practice, he wouldn't be getting a person from good actions. No, that's a good question. I'm not totally sure.
Maybe the person's like a bit of a hero at this stage and decided that he's heroic enough, you know, to dismantle the spikes,
mm-hmm.
whether it's with a, you know, a club or whatever.
But,
so
well, it did say that the instruments were being wielded by the expert
okay.
stopper.
Mean by the expert.
And if it's coming from infinite power and knowledge,
yeah.
wouldn't that be because only the Sadhguru would know how
yeah.
to dismantle the sanskaras?
Mm-hmm.
I would imagine what this translates into meaning, although it doesn't say this, is that the Sadhguru. Obedience to the Sadhguru would be this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the instruments, his infinite knowledge and power, he gives orders, and when you follow them, those are the good actions.
Usually the good actions are the right actions by the Buddhist. You know, the Buddhists say right view, right
action,
right speech.
Yeah, I think it would probably be the same thing.
And stopping the world wheel.
Yes.
The wheel of causation.
Yeah, this is a very Buddhist image, and it is the idea of a whirling thing.
Yeah.
It makes me think at this time, I don't know, I've never seen a cotton jenny. Have any of you ever seen that? They had devices like this.
They're on YouTube, yes.
Huh?
Cotton gin.
A cotton gin, yeah.
Yeah.
I heard
you said
cotton
gin. I did, I meant to say cotton gin. It doesn't have like whirling things.
Yeah.
So they had devices like machinery like that on the agricultural scene.
Yeah, threshers.
And I imagine if you got cotton one, you would regret it. It's my original impression. So this is but it makes me, it's like the Buddhist wheel, the law, which will be the topic in 2 weeks, by the way, to bring up dependent arising and the wheel of the law. But I've never seen an analogy like this from Bhatma before. It's a very unique sort of thing. And I like him to say, it does no good to stand back and say, oh machine, stop spinning. What use is this work, the spinning of yours? It doesn't do any good at all. You need someone who actually has the knowledge and power to use them in that. Now, I guess maybe I better go and turn to the last topic. There are some other nice things. I'll just mention there are a lot of interesting things, but one of them is Baba does give an explanation of knowledge of the three paths of karma, jnana, and bhakti yoga. You know, those are the three great paths in the Bhagavad Gita and many other places, and Baba has affirmed those also. And he has a lecture where he explains those are rooted in the triune nature of God as knowledge, power, and bliss. And this is one of those cases where the original had a big space for a chart to explain this whole point, and the chart was missing. And so finally, when the Pearson's manuscript came up there, here, I thought I should at least the chart. It's the redone chart is here somewhere.
One evening, Baba gave his mother some spiritual experiences. Is it easy to find, or are you in the long stage?
Yeah, where he gives them the...
quite interesting.
Yeah, that was... Here's this... here's the chart we found right there.
Mm-hmm.
And I would never have known it would show that. This is really, really important metaphysical information. I mean... I don't know how to convey this, but it's like these three paths have been in Hinduism right at the center of the Bhagavad Gita for 2,000 years anyway. They're really central to Hinduism. And Baba, you'll find it in a number of like the deeper aspects of sadhana, talks about the three paths. many other places. And here, he shows the clear point is that each one of them is rooted in one of the triune natures of God. Thus, karma, this is one of those cases where the 19th century maiden of you was swooning when I saw this chart, because it was such an extraordinary piece of information. Like Gyan Yoga, knowledge yoga, is rooted in God's, and leads to God's nature's knowledge. Bhakti Yoga is rooted in and leads to God's nature as bliss. And Karma Yoga is rooted in and leads to God's nature as power. Now, I think this is completely new information. I've never seen this anywhere before, actually. And it's really worth some thinking on, like, try to think, why is Karma Yoga related to God's nature as power? Well, what is Karma Yoga about? Action. And what is action? The exercise of power. And why is Karma Yoga a yoga? Because you're acting selflessly. You're making use of power while renouncing the fruit of action. That's what makes it a yoga. So he says a lot of the great rulers of the world are, kings of the world are former karma yogis who acquired the merit in that way. Similarly, bhakti yoga is rooted in God's nature as bliss. And when I think about it, bliss is indeed the dominant characteristic of love. That is, bliss in its dual aspects of agony and ecstasy, right? Wouldn't that be true? When you're in love with someone, I'm 16 years old, I'm in love with this beautiful girl, and oh, she doesn't love me, agony. She loves me, bliss, right? Those two traits are directly related to love. So in the path of bhakti yoga, what makes it a yoga? What makes it a spiritual path? You seek the bliss, you seek the pleasure, not of yourself, but of the beloved. You try to please the beloved. You're constantly, it's not your own happiness, but it's the beloved's happiness. That's the focus. So, I mean, this is really a deeply revealing piece of information about it in here. So this whole Tiffin lecture is on this topic. That's the chart that...
What do those words say?
What's that?
What do those words say that
inside the column.
You should or the other.
I think in the redrawn chart we probably put it in, but let's see. Power... sorry, it's too blurry to read. Some of it's in...
The
other side has it. Yeah. Let's see. It's kind of blurry.
The path that leads
to the path of joy with enjoyment. But I can't read it.
The path of joy and its enjoyment by
musts and so. Can you read that word? If we actually just go and show it. Ahatmas, an advanced something, karma yoga, on the path of enjoyment of power. And the first one, knowledge.
Path that leads to seeing.
Seeing. And that word is sakshatkar. The sakshatkar means the immediate presence. Sakshatkar, paramatma, means paramatma, immediately present and seen by me.
Seeing God face to face.
Seeing God face to face, yeah. So that's the path of knowledge there. So there is a paragraph on each of those in the course of this. So this is actually a very highly significant Tiffin lecture, giving information that, as best I know, is nowhere else anywhere in Baba's teachings, and that really completes the picture of his...
Does Baba associate Bhakti Yoga with the growth plan and Jnana Yoga with mental plan in this discourse? I can't remember.
That connection is not made here specifically. No. No, that would actually come from God Speaks and not from here. But let's see, he's you were asking about in
only if it's easy to
find. Yeah, I think it is. Yeah, this is very, very interesting things here. A bunch of riddles. Yeah, so in November they were tearing apart the ashram. And so then, almost on the eve of their departure from Mirabai, in a rare session with the Mandali, Baba gave his men the taste of subtle experience with a glimpse and echo of subtle sight and hearing. You know, I remember Erich describing something like this much later on. So that was the only time I ever heard of Baba doing this. Anyone want to read this?
All were instructed to close their eyes for a short time. After 3 or 4 minutes had passed, they were ordered to open their eyes again. Asked what they had experienced, some said that they had at first seen only darkness, but then out of that darkness small circles of light appeared, and in the end only one circle remained. Thereupon Sri explained, "All of you closed your eyes. Now when your eyes were closed, who was it that actually saw these circles of light and the rest of it, as you have just related? It was your mind that saw all of this through your subtle eye, even though your gross eye was closed. That is, even though you were looking into darkness. Now this seeing of circles constitutes a step on the path towards seeing the Almighty, who is the eternal light. At first you see circles, then colours, then skies, until at last you see the very fountain of light, truth itself, the winning of which is the aim, object, and intention of everyone."
By the way, in his discussion of the yogas, I think it's Gyan Yogi, he talks about the fountain of infinite light that you see at the end of that path.
If you could see all these things, the circles, colors, skies, and so forth, with your eyes open, then you could be said to have developed the powers of your subtle eye. Many of you and many others in the world must have closed your eyes from time to time with an intention of seeing something. But has this explanation, as I have just given it, ever occurred to you or anyone else? None of the really experienced ones has ever explained this to you in such clear terms. Although to us, who have not only seen but actually become one with the eternal light, this business of seeing circles and colours and so forth is only too trivial. This light that you see with your subtle eye is the sixth shadow of that real and original light which pervades the whole universe. The subtle eye itself takes the shape of a circle of light with a spot in its center.
Isn't that interesting? That's what the subtle eye looks like.
When some people do meditation for years, they may not get access to this, but just by the present Baba, at Baba's whim, these people are given this.
Just a few days before this, one of the people living with the Mandali, his name is Gopal Swami, he was one of the Sadhaka, five men who went into the Sadhaka ashram in the next year, and he had come seeking God. And of all the people doing that, he was the most sincere. Baba really liked him a lot. Well, he had had an experience of an exalted company, sort of a congress, like up in heaven, and all of a sudden they started honoring and cheering someone who arrived, and it was Baba in some kind of a high, subtle form. And Baba then talked a lot. He called that Sakshatkar Darshan, and he, and not here but elsewhere, said there was someone in America who at that moment was having even an higher kind of darshan of him and could see him in his very physical form all the time. That's even higher than what Gopal Swami had. So there was a little bit of dealing with some of these inner experiences that was happening. This is just before they left Mirabai, just before they broke up and left. They were tearing the whole place down right when this was happening. So here's part two. That was part one. Yeah. Keep going, or anyone else want to read?
In just the same way, Sri proceeded to give his mandali the experience of inner hearing, together with an explanation. First, he ordered all of them tightly to seal off their ears for 3 or 4 minutes. And then he asked each one what had been his experience. They replied that at first silence prevailed, but subsequently they heard distant sounds as of rolling thunderclouds or a moving train. After that, they heard sounds far off, like train whistles. Again, Sri explained.
Isn't it kind of surprising, those particular sounds, train whistles?
These were sounds that were explained by the Shabad Surat Yoga people, Kerbal Singh's people. These are some of the sounds people hear.
Oh, did they?
Yes.
Keep going.
Since your ears were tightly sealed off from outer sound, you heard these things. Again, it was this same mind that heard through your subtle ear. These sounds are the sixth shadow of the real and original sound. If you were to proceed and progress onwards, developing this new hearing faculty of yours further, you would begin to hear pleasing musical notes, nadas, as are heard on the planes of consciousness.
Okay, why don't we keep going a little bit? This gives a sense of the subtle senses and stuff.
Elaborating further on some of these details, Sri gave the figure of 3 curtains, one gross, one subtle, and one of the mind, that intervene between you, ordinary man, and the real truth, or Paramatma.
By the way, we're starting to get the 3 spheres now, gross, subtle, and mental. In the second half of 1926, Baba started to explain that.
If you throw aside the first of these, the curtain of the gross, you have then to act through the medium of the subtle, which, when thrown aside and given up, leaves you with no recourse except to act through the mind alone. And when you throw aside and finally give up this mind of yours, then you become one with Paramatma. Now, suppose one progresses by means of seeing through the gross, the subtle, and the mind, crossing each of these domains and giving up all 3. In the end, one attains the Satchitananda state. But before this, while still experiencing the sphere of mind, one sees the fountain of light, experiencing its charm, realizing its greatness and power, one tries to move toward it. That is to say, until now, the pilgrim has only seen, but now he wants to actually proceed toward the goal. And only a very, very few actually succeed in becoming one with that everlasting light, existence, knowledge and truth. It is almost impossible to become the personification of truth, though a few lucky ones do manage to reach up as far as the mental sphere. Only a few rare viralas, heroes, unite with the Satchitananda root or state, becoming realized through a Satguru's grace.
So there Baba gave them a little taste of experiences. You know, again, this to me is so much the training of the mandali. It was not their role, most of them, to have experiences like this. But he gave them just a taste so that they would have some idea what it was.
A conviction, Father.
And so that they could talk to people about this. It wouldn't be completely outside their ken. They would have a little bit of an experience of it as a basis for dealing with others who were having such experiences as this. But that's all. They give them this much, and then they're taking off, leaving Maribod, going to Lanavla, all that kind of thing happening. We have only about 20 minutes, so I wanted to say a little bit about what a book like this is meant to be and do as a book. That is to say, because I think it's I'll just say a few things about this. I feel that as the years go on, this chair starts spinning and can't just be like that. It's a machine and it won't stop. But as in the decades and we're coming into, Baba's words are going to be one of the really important sources of authority for people. Because people will be looking, well, what did Baba actually want of his lovers? How do I know what Mayor Baba wants, and so forth? And, institutional authorities will play their role, but people will say, why should I believe somebody just because he's associated with Avatar's Abode? The Mayor Center, what is that anyway? Why should I believe you? That question will come up. And so one of the places that people will go to will say, I want to know what Mayor Baba himself said. So they'll start going to his books and his words. But all the same questions can be asked about that. Why should I believe these are really Mayor Baba's words? After all, he was silent. He didn't say any words at all. This is all going to happen. We haven't really come into the period where these questions are big, but I do think they will become big. One of the purposes that this the trust work, I work with a trust in India in this very line, is to create editions of Baba's words that are as reliable as we can make them. In his last, Baba had a last will and testament. Did you know that? He actually had a last will and testament. And the main topic in it is copyright, oddly enough. He makes all these provisions for copyrights. The Sufis, he had given the copyright to God Speaks and other things, and he confirms that and says things like that. But the main thing is that he says, it's almost word for word this. He says, I own the copyrights in all my literary works, published and unpublished, direct and indirect, including, and then he gives a long list, not of titles of works, but of types of things, discourses, diagrams, all sorts of different genres, literary genres. What at the trust, he gave the copyrights of all that to the Avatar Mirabod Trust. So what we took that to mean is that Baba is saying he is the author of works like this that are, we call them unpublished and indirect, because they come to us not directly from Baba, but by through the notes of Chanji. I don't know if you're following the logic of this. So, this is actually a policy decision. There's been a lot of discussion at the trust on this very matter. So these are being published as Baba's words, but they're being published as things that were not published during his own lifetime. They're indirect. That is to say, they're through the medium of somebody like Chanji. And things like this that were not published in Baba's own lifetime, with his name on them and author, with his own approval, like discourses would be that, or God Speaks. Those things he himself had published during his own lifetime. These are not in that category. And these things we're trying to publish as critical editions. That's what these are. That is, editions based on a complete study of all available sources as much as possible. Baba did indicate that he wanted his, at least there are a lot of their statements from him that he wanted it, his words edited. He gave some directions about how this should be done. And it should be completely open and transparent. In fact, these are the three criteria that put here. Three imperatives in the creation of critical editions of Meher Baba's words. One, exhaustive study of all relevant sources, documentary and other. Two, editorial principles that are consistent and objective in editorial practices attuned to the kind of editing that Baba wanted. And three, transparency in these matters through instruments of disclosure within the edition itself. So, like, this is being presented as a book of Meher Baba's authorship, but it's very edited. You know, a lot of it Baba probably dictated Gujarati. So all that source material is being presented in the notes. If you actually, for people who actually go through the notes, you can find out what all the sources were. You could see the earliest transcriptions by Chanji and the later subsequent revisions and compilations of it that he did. On these editorial principles and practices like that, here's an example. I'm mentioning it because we're here at Avatar's Abode. Baba had asked Francis Brabazon to do a new edition of God Speaks. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with that point. And here at the Abode, you have about 15, 20 pages in Francis's own handwriting of his re-edit, his beginnings of his re-edit of God Speaks. In a letter to Ivy Deuce, Francis mentions this and says that Baba liked it. Okay, so here we have an example of the kind of editing that apparently Baba wanted and liked. Baba had given him certain directions about how the editing should be done. So that's the kind of thing that's relevant here, editing that's done according to principles and practices that Baba seems to have indicated during his lifetime. We have various statements from him on this kind of thing. I'm giving a real quick introduction to a big topic. But one of the reasons why I really do feel a commitment to talking about this is that the real curators of all of this, I feel, are Baba's lovers in the world at large, who are free and to evaluate and criticize what gets presented as Baba's words. It's not something just to be taken as, well, these are Baba's words. These are very edited. They're based on study and research. And the community of Baba's lovers are encouraged, in my opinion, to praise it for yourself and say, do I actually accept that this is a valid account of what Meher Baba's words are? I think it is positively healthy for a certain critical attitude and skepticism to be there, which is why I'm talking about it. And I have to turn my phone on, my battery was running out. I wanted to show you some of what's in the Avatar Mirabal Trust website provided as tools for this. Part of the whole transparency and disclosure. Is this making sense?
Mm-hmm.
You know, these editions are not being done on any kind of, you know, spiritual authority or anything like that. They're being done as scholarly works based on the study of available sources and can be subjected to the same criticism as anything else can be.
So it's likely in the future maybe there are other documents uncovered that are related to these?
Certainly.
So it could actually be expanded.
They certainly will be.
What arises, like you were talking about those, the diagrams and things that were missing for all those years, there might be more.
almost certainly they will be. Mm-hmm. Or people may find mistakes. Mm-hmm. Or they may say, this fundamental approach is wrong. It shouldn't have been done this way. You know, all, you know, this could and should be open to free discussion, I certainly think.
There was some controversy on the discourses being re-edited, isn't it?
Yeah, this has come up. I could talk for a long time on this very subject because it's been right at the center of what I do at the Trust. But, the seventh edition of the discourses was published in 1987. It was edited by Erich Bolotu and Flag Chris. Do you know Flag Chris? He passed away 20 years ago. And in the early 2000s, there was a very highly articulate attack on the seventh edition on our website. It was actually well done, I thought. The people doing it said, what business did anybody have in re-editing and revising the words of the Avatar? It was published as the sixth edition, that three volumes set, and nobody has any business reworking what Baba's published words were. I mean, it's a fair point, actually. Now, the trust really went into this a lot, and actually, someone does have a memory of Mani talking about this, saying that Baba had asked for a new edition to be done. But it's just one person's memory. It's actually my own rules would have a second corroboration needed before I would fully accept this. So what we actually decided at the Trust was we're not going to shut down the seventh edition. I mean, with Erich and Balma too signed on for it, you know, I'm not going to be the one to say they couldn't do that. And who knows what they knew from Baba about this. However, Baba's lovers are free to take as authoritative whichever edition seems right to them. So we republished the sixth edition, actually, to make that available. And the five volume set can also be republished if there's a sufficient demand for it. But other things that were published in Baba's own lifetime, God Speaks and other things like that, we leave alone. We don't re-edit those. We'll re-edit to this extent. An edition that where typos are corrected, let's say. Or let's say in the discourses it says, is you will see on table 17, table 3, they don't get to 17, on page 147. Well, if there's a new edition, and it's now on page 152, I don't think we're bound for the next 700 years to keep saying 147, just because, obviously it's a cross-reference. So a little bit of common sense on it. But apart from that, the Trust position is that these things don't get revised. But things that were not published in Baba's lifetime, those are edited fully. And the Trust position is that the authoritative texts are the sources, not the published edition. The edition is subject to critique and review and re-editing, as a matter of fact, because there's nothing holy or sacrosanct about that. And to help with that, we're trying to make all the sources for all of this fully available to Baba's lovers. So let me just show you on the website, if I can manage to. I got this up earlier, and who knows, maybe I can again. I had to turn my phone off because the battery was running out. Let's see if this is going to work. Okay, has that come up?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is in the Trust website. I won't try to show you how to get there. You have to search down a little bit. But I'll go back. So this would be a section on Tiffin Lecture sources. So if you wanted to see what the sources are, here are the different, you can click on manuscripts, and Here they are. They hopefully will come up. Yeah. So let's see. Here's the one of the main ones is Chanji's diary number 57, right here. Like this. And if you go to the back of Tiffin Lectures, there are various tables and other tools that will show what the relevant pages are, other things like that.
Is this material on the web already in the printed volume?
Well, this is on the web. This is on the Trust website.
In this book.
Yes, in the book.
I don't think this book is
the original resources out there.
The book will. Here, I'll show you what. You know, all of this won't. I mean, you won't find all these sources in the book. The book would have been 2,000 pages
but
long.
Did you get the list?
Huh?
You get the list of the sources?
There are various listings there. There's a lot of stuff in the back. There's really quite a lot. Here, I'll show you in a second how the end of it. So, like, this is really coming up slowly. Sorry, it's a bit so slow.
It's regional Australia.
Connection is no good. But Chanji's diary number 57, page 17. So you could actually if it ever happens. Vodafone. I blame Vodafone.
Is this using your phone as a hotspot?
Huh?
Is this using your phone as a hotspot?
Yeah, that's what I'm doing.
But there's often not many bars here in Barbara's house, and sometimes people get SOS emergency calls only here in this building.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, well, this. Let me show you something else. Maybe I can get... This is taking so long. But, oops. Did I go all the way back to here?
That'll come up.
I think it's going to be under publications. Tiffin Lectures. So, I mean, a lot of the text that you'll read in the book is based on a whole bunch of sources, like the primary source would be the Pearson's manuscript, the compiled typed version. But a lot of times there will be Chanji's diaries will be brought in and used for things like that. And there's a...
Is there one that's a particular smaller volume?
Well, I'm going to show you, here are the endnotes. These are actually the endnotes to the Tiffin Lectures. And I know that's the first thing you're all going to do is read the endnotes. They're just, I mean, how can you resist a cliffhanger like TLDDF286261 provides a very abbreviated account of the story. Okay, so here you're going to get all this kind of detailed stuff. So if you clicked on that, you would get to that very abbreviated account of that story. Let me go down below where... from Chanji's diary, you get a much fuller version of it. You click on that, and again, it's not coming up. Oh, here it is. There it is.
Wow.
So there you can actually see Chanji's, one of these accounts in Chanji's diaries. So it's these endnotes that give a detailed discussion of editorial questions and problems that came up. Everything that seemed to have any noteworthy significance, in my opinion, as an endnote, and all the sources can be reached through this. So you see, this is an attempt to be transparent, so that people can, anyone want to say, well, are these Baba's words? Why should I believe these are Baba's words? Okay, well, check it out for yourself. Here it is, here are the sources. Now, I know that most people aren't actually going to do this, but there will be some who will as time goes on. And I would say, at least as long as I'm involved in it, the Trust is completely committed to doing editions of Baba's words this way. That is to say, before you say Baba said something, you look at all the sources and you're completely transparent as to what they were, just so the reader will know what they are. Infinite intelligence, man, did that ever need editing? the original text is written in a highly artificial language. It's nobody's natural prose style. I could explain why I think that was, but people wouldn't read it if that's what they had. And it's a clear case where it needs to get rewritten in ordinary language. So we did that. We revised the prose enormously. But somebody wants to say, well, what is your authorization for such revision? Well, we have a comment from Baba where he said, my discourses can be rewritten, it's very close to this, almost word for word, in stylish and forceful prose. Those are his words. But the spirit and meaning must remain unchanged. That was his statement on it. So, okay, there's the criterion. Try to write it in stylish and forceful prose without changing the spirit and meaning. And somebody says, well, you haven't done that. Okay, so what?
You do it.
Yeah, here's the source. Here's the source. Say what your criticism is. And people shouldn't hesitate to. I mean, I think there are no holy cows here. There's nothing sacrosanct about this work. We did the best job we could. And this is to help anybody who wants, actually, beyond just criticizing an edition, you want to sort of say, I really would like to know what Meher Baba said. Thank you for your edited edition, but that's not good enough for me. Wonderful, wonderful. Go to the sources and find out for yourself. And in my opinion, if you really want to know what Meher Baba said, you had to be there, because he was silent. And there may be people in the future who will do that, who will somehow bring themselves into a state of directly experiencing Meher Baba's communication. I fully believe there will be such people. So, okay, go for it. Like that. So here's, this is some of the instruments of, tools for research. I just want to show, so those are all the endnotes. I mean, I know most people won't go to the endnotes, but I spent years on them, I would say. No idea, one little citation, how much work was involved in locating that, in establishing its use. But also, within the book itself, there is this one appendix. If it comes up, you know what, I don't need to go there, I can go to the book. Let's see where, we'll see it, right here.
Are the figures in that section as well, on the website?
What's that?
The figures in the book?
Yes, the figures are all there, I didn't show them because it's so slow. But each of the figures, it will show the original figure, and will show all the source figures and tell you where they are. But here's a table. I know these things may look imposing, but in fact, this is a very, for anyone who's interested in this, this is a most useful thing. What this table does is it gives, like for each lecture, like this would be the lecture of 29th April 1926, and these are the pages of the book, of the published book, right? Here, it will tell you all sources pertaining to that. Like in Chanji's diary number 62, page 321 is one of the sources for pages 6 or 7. Or here are two other typed drafts. These, A and B, these are also sources for that. Down here, page 348 of Chanji's diary 62. And again, these two are sources for these pages of the published book. So if you're reading page 33 and you wanted to find the sources, one way would be go to this table and they're all listed. And then you can go to those sources that are right there in the Trust website and look them up for yourself. In the course of time, we'd like to have highlighted in those pages the portions that are relevant. I mean, this is an enormous amount of work. I don't have any idea how much work it is to have done all of this, so it will take time. But this is part of the idea of what I'm committed to, and I think all of Baba's words need to be done this way, where people know what they're getting, for anyone interested. Like, here's like one example of you need this. There's a diary by Baba's disciple Bailey. You know Bailey? He's one of the earliest, one of Baba's childhood friends, and was with Baba way back when no one else was. Bailey was quite a character. He was a real troublemaker, a real rake, you know. And he got put in jail, actually, and did all sorts of things that no one liked, you know. He was one of Baba's mandala, no doubt about it. He wrote a diary in Gujarati, and a lot of it includes even like the teens, 1918, 1917. There are no other diaries about that period. And then he lost them. He lost all his diaries. And much later, in the late 50s and 60s, he rewrote them from memory. Okay. So he's a guy, whose veracity many people questioned. Not about his diaries, but about, you know, he was not an outstanding moral character. About his mandala. Okay. In his diary, he's highly repentant of the life he's led. And feels that he blew it. He was so connected with Baba and he lived this terrible life. He talks that way a lot. Okay, so now you've got a diary written in 1962 in Gujarati about something that happened in 1917 that he's remembering. So let's suppose he says, Baba said thus and such. Are you going to quote that as an absolutely authoritative account of exactly the words that Baba said? Of course not. Of course not. But it's the only account by one of Baba's own disciples. So people need to know this, you know. I'm not actually disparaging his accounts. I mean, I think he's been quite sincere and all of that. But when people say Baba said thus and such, we need some critical assessment as to whether he really did or in what sense he did. Here's another example. Paul Brunton wrote all these accounts. You know Paul Brunton? Mm-hmm. Of the things Baba said. Are you going to take that as absolute gospel account of Baba's words? So we need to have a critical assessment of all the words attributed to Mary Baba. So there's my diatribe on that subject. And this book is an attempt to do this. And that's why it took 20 years. If we hadn't done this, we could have done it in 6 months. But I think that all of Baba's unpublished words need to be done this way, with full research of sources, editing according to the principles he gave, and complete transparency and openness to the Baba world, where Baba lovers are free to make their own assessments of what they're getting. And I don't think Baba lovers should just accept something as Baba's words just because somebody says so.
Are you doing this with the combined diaries and with the Premashram?
The combined diaries are a little bit different because they're not Baba's words exactly.
Okay. But the Premashram, it has Baba's sayings and teachings.
Oh, it is Baba's mm-hmm. words. That's another case.
So you're doing
case
the same thing.
Completely. Yeah. Yeah. Full critical assessment of everything.
Bailey's diaries.
Huh?
Bailey's diaries.
Yeah, we're not involved with those. I don't know what's happening.
Isn't Jahangir doing some work on that?
Hmm?
Didn't Jahangir do some work with the translation of some of that?
Did he? I didn't know that.
David?
Yeah.
I know he's given talks, because he knows a lot of that Bali stuff. And,
right.
Yeah, so he's given talks on related information. So.
Yeah.
But actually, in the end, it's not my work. Perhaps I should tread carefully, but all quotes attributed to Baba and Lord Meher we need to know the sources, you know, and they need to be critically examined. I mean, there has been a lot of good editorial work on that, but it has. We don't have the complete apparatus of transparency with it. So we need to have all of that. This is going to take generations of work. And right now there may not be many people who care that much, but that will change. All we need is a good war between different factions of Bible lovers, and then everything will change.
You're setting a great standard. Well, the Trust is now setting a very good standard.
I hope so. As people go into it, they'll find faults all over the place. But we're trying to do the best. We're trying to be honest also, so people can assess it. So nobody is being asked just to accept this. Not at all. I mean, right off the bat, people were saying, are these Baba's words? Well, for one thing, a lot of it was in Gujarati, so obviously not. But Baba, they themselves were starting this process. I mean, I haven't talked about all of this, but there's a lot of evidence that they were working this material up towards publishing it as a book at the time, it looks like that. Well, it's 10 after 4, so we'll have a break. So thank you very much. Jee Baba, everybody.